I possibly live up to that? So thank you, and thanks very much to the organisers for asking me to do this. It's a wonderful opportunity to meet up with friends and a fantastic opportunity to be here and share some ideas with you. And there are many amazing images of patterns in the natural world. This road-based cauliflower here arrived in our vegetable box a couple of weeks ago, and it amazes me that each little floret is like a copy of the whole thing, almost like a fractal, and how it grows as it spirals out from the centre. And there are many amazing real-life examples of growth patterns following this Fibonacci sequence, which tends to the golden ratio. We can view mathematically related shapes in naturally occurring man-made patterns, almost like looking at pictures in an art gallery. I think we view and interpret patterns using and extending our own structures of understanding that everybody can appreciate the beauty of what's in front of them. For me, representation is about capturing, about bottling up mathematical truths and structure in order to get a handle on them and almost play with it like Lego and share our thinking with others. I think it's the beauty of the patterns that prompts us to keep scrutinising them and how the pattern fits together, and I think that this further promotes light of inquiry and shared dialogue. And before long, we're almost playing with a network of mathematical concepts and relationships as we study these patterns and how they fit together. And looking at many patterns over time, I think it's almost as if they provide a universal language that transcends time and culture down the generations. So what I'd like to do is to share some images with you, some historical and some of the day, which I feel illustrate the art of representation. I'm going to look at some ancient examples, and then how Leonardo uses his artistic talent to promote mathematical inquiry. I'd then like to look at some kinds of patterns which have inspired me to think about work in the classroom, and at the time before we were working on some related tasks. What I'd like to do first of all is to share with you my earliest recollections of representation. I always remember the time when I felt I was playing with mathematical ideas in a very basic sense, and how this was only brought on by looking at the family clock, which was a wedding present from my grandparents to my parents. So, this is the clock. And when I was coming up to 6 and my sister was coming up to 9, I can remember looking at this clock and thinking about our ages on it. And I then remember thinking, well, as the clock hands go round, what age will I be then? And then as they went round further, it was really pulling my thinking into thinking, well, what age will I be when it's on the 1? What about when it's back on the 1? And I think quite optimistically, I had myself going round the clock 8 times, and I'm not quite sure when I'm going to get to be that age, but I certainly thought all the time. And one thing I think for me was that this room opened up Aladdin's cave for me into the mathematics around me, and how I really amused myself in the most boring and dull situations that a 6-year-old finds himself in. And I think that what's interesting here is that not only can mathematics give rise to representation when we want to think mathematically, we want to come up with representations, perhaps with each other's, but also how representation can give rise to mathematics, and this works certainly for young children, even if they don't really articulate it too much with adults at the time. I'd like to begin by looking at 2 well-known examples of plain tablets from the old Babylonian period. I think this period is really fascinating, about 1600 to 1800 BC, the area between the Tigris and the Euphrates, ancient Mesopotamia, often called the cradle of civilization for everything that happened there. And you see ancient civilizations, of course, described in the Bible, roughly corresponding to modern day Iraq. So this tablet, sorry, it hasn't come out that well here, but it's in the British Museum, and it's the British Museum tablet 15285, and it shows that it's small problems, and they can't see them that well there from the back. There are shapes inscribed within squares, and the idea there is to find the areas. It's a whole set of small problems. And the next tablet that I'm going to show, there is some very possibility that the next tablet could actually be the solution to one of these. So the next tablet I'm going to show is the famous YBC 7289 tablet from the Young Babylonian collection. And this one is thought to have been produced by a trained scribe. because the imprints on it are quite large at the time once I've been training. It's in cuneiform script, and we can see that the wedge shapes are either kind of going like less than signs or they're more upright. It's sextilistical notation, which is base 60. It's got a sub base of 10. So each of the group of markings represents a digit up to 59. And the little less than signs, the wide wedges are like tens, and the upright narrow ones are like ones. So we have a group of up to 5 of the little less than signs being 50, and 9 of the little upright ones, making a grouping there of 59. So looking at the sign of the square, that shows 30. I think most of it say 30 there, although there has been some talk whether that could possibly be 0.5 because there isn't any top decimal point there as such, so it could be 30 to 60, it's 0.5. Going across, apparently they would have had a kind of ready reckoner, if you like, of coefficients, which they would have referred to for that ratio of the side length to the diagonal of the square. And you can see here, looking at the little wedge shapes, that I have the 1, the 24, 60ths, if you like, what would be effectively the first decimal place, then 51 over 60 squared, and 10 over 60 cubed, and so on, giving really quite a good approximation. And then underneath here, we're multiplied by the side length, we've got their approximation there for what the length would be on that particular square. It's quite interesting that if we take that as 0.5, then the root 2 and then the 1 over would actually have been reciprocals. Although, of course, it could easily be 30, which is the more likely interpretation, 30 and then 30 times root 2. I'm going to start to have a look at Leonardo da Vinci. I'm absolutely fascinated by how Leonardo tried to understand how so many disciplines link together and how he uses his understanding of art to try to put his understanding into paintings. I've been very fortunate to spend a little bit of time with Martin Penn, shown here, pointing at his clock because he rather liked the way I showed him with my way with my family clock there. And he has become a real world-renowned scholar on Leonardo. He's written many, many books, and these are two of the ones I've been looking at. The top one, I've just fascinated me a great deal, where he looks hugely at the different aspects of what Leonardo was looking at in terms of science and representation and so on. And this bottom one is newly being published, and I actually have that with me if anybody's interested in seeing that. He said that the wedding for him was a little bit more like the Pulpower picture I showed you. He studied natural sciences at Cambridge, and that was the way in for him, was looking at scientific images and that drew him into art. So what really interests me, as I say, with Leonardo, is how he accomplished so much in terms of painting and sculpture, architecture, anatomy, geometry and science. But it's what he does in terms of representation, which leads him to work on mathematics, that I find particularly interesting. So he was really interested in how geometry and anatomy come together. And he looked at the work of Vitruvius, a first century Roman architect, who wrote about 10 books. I think it was the third of these books, where he looks at the proportions of the human body and how these ought to be reflected in buildings, in temples. Vitruvius writes about the man and how we can have the hands and the feet positioned in the circle. But it's only Leonardo that puts both images in the same place. And it's only Leonardo that effectively dislocates the centres. Other people at the time, even though Vitruvius didn't actually say this, had assumed that you had to have the same centre for both. But Leonardo was to say dislocates those, and in dislocating those, he had the body in perfect proportion and actually sitting beautifully within that circle. It interests me when we actually think about the circles would be traced out if you were to move his hands and his legs. So if he moves his arm, that the fulcrum here is at the shoulder, and that's actually going to move away from the circle the second he moves that arm. And the same with his legs, because of course the radius of those circles is different from the radius of the circle that we see here. Attempting to square the circle by construction to come up with a circle and square in the same area, was a problem that remained elusive, and Leonardo was extremely interested in this and shows lots of diagrams where effectively he tries to kind of produce a curvilinear shape and actually tries to get that mapped onto a kind of rectilinear shape. It was as if he thought that if he were to break the problem down enough, that he might get there in the end. And in some writings, he says that at the last part of the candle, he thought he'd crack the problem. But obviously, it did remain elusive there. It's interesting in the Rhine papyrus from about 1650 BC, I mean, that was copied from an original a couple hundred years earlier. But they thought that if they could cut about a ninth off the diameter of the circle, they could get to the side length of the square in the same area. And that's a reasonably good approximation. Lindemann proved that the problem by construction is impossible, but a lovely mathematician, Vermanagem, he got an incredibly close approximation, which I think would make about a quarter of an inch out on a circle of about 144,000 square miles. It would only be a quarter of an inch out on the side length of the square. Leonardo spent some years living with a mathematician called Pacioli. Pacioli was a tutor of mathematics, and Leonardo, up until that point, had been really quite an interesting novice, but actually became really extremely proficient mathematically after they spent that time working together, especially in geometry. Martin Kemp was saying that Leonardo actually found any algebraic reasoning really quite distasteful because he liked the kind of mathematics that he could really kind of get his hands on. He produced some drawings here for Pacioli's book, and I think it's really interesting how he moves forward the kind of representation that was possible at the time in order that you can actually see through the faces here of the polyhedra. So he did a number of these drawings called fenestrated after the French word for window. Leonardo himself called them vacuous. And I think it's great that in Pacioli's book, there are a number of letters that were done. These were all in woodcut for the, it was 1599, which showed all in woodcut. The M is in the net and was used as their an emblem until just recently. And once again, bringing Pacioli's work with the greatest art in Western Hemisphere, the largest museum in Western Hemisphere of art, bringing the two together once again. I think that representation was the starting point for Leonardo. He didn't just stop where Pacioli left him with, could he produce these beautiful drawings for him, these illustrations for him, but he goes on himself to think about working on the volume of the dodecahedron. He takes one of the faces as the base of a pyramid, and it's as if you can split it up. And even when he's got one of those again, he takes that face and he actually splits that through again, chunking it down, trying to break it down into parts that you can get a handle on. I think there might be a little bit of jewelry poetry in the last couple of stages there, but he's certainly trying to break it down. It fascinates me again that he's so interested in representation, which is such a key aspect of what any mathematician would be interested in. And how he starts looking at equivalent volumes, even in a basic sense that I'm going to get my head around, I can see looking at the box at the bottom, how he can take one face and actually take equivalent volume by thinking about the pyramid and taking the points out from there and the relationship between the length of the base and the length of the pyramid. And again, you can take it again from a different base. So I'm looking here at the bottom diagram there. He also looked at Pythagoras and whether Pythagoras would hold for cubes. I think it's interesting to think what 2D or 3D shapes Pythagoras would work for. And in fact, the first time I met John Mason, I was in Cambridge and Charlie Gildegard had invited him in. And the first thing that he asked everybody to look at, again, was relationships with Pythagoras. So what's interesting here is that we can actually see from his jottings that he's trying 4 cubed there and he's trying 3 cubed. And you can see that they add up to 91, not 125 that would be required for 5 cubed. And he tries various drawings and equivalent shapes and so on. And of course, what we need is any 2D or 3D shape, where the area, if we're looking at areas, or the volume, if we're looking at volumes, is proportional to the square of the side length. So anything proportional to the square of the side length is going to be the trick. and anything else, of course, won't. So, looking at this painting, this was only recently authenticated as Leonardo, son of Tom Lundy, and quite fitting, saviour of the world at Easter time. It's interesting here, this was sold in 1958 for just £45. And authenticated as Leonardo to a Russian investor for 127.5 million. Martin Kemp was just talking about had an instrumental part to play here, and he says it had that kind of presence that Leonardo's had, that uncanny strangeness that the later Leonardo paintings manifest. So that's what Martin Kemp had to say about it. He says that Leonardo's understanding of anatomy was so amazing, and how he could really see underneath the sort of skin of how the knuckle would work and so on, that it had to be Leonardo, because, as I say, he had that incredible understanding. And also then, not only just looking at that, the way that the hair is done and so on. It's interesting with Leonardo, he banked with Santa Maria Nuova in Florence, and they had a hospital there where he actually was able to do some dissections. And in doing those dissections, he got an incredibly good understanding of the human body and anatomy, which was incredibly unusual and beyond his time then. These Islamic patterns were coming in into Venice from the port of Turkey, and Leonardo was very interested in these patterns. And again, what particularly interests me with this painting, looking at the skull, you can see some of this pattern work that he's produced here, the way he's extended those patterns. It doesn't show up quite so well at the back. So in terms of what makes Leonardo such a master of representation, I think for me it's the fact that he tries to put what he understands into a painting. It's almost as if he's actually trying to reconstruct reality rather than actually trying to look at what reality shows and then try to represent it. He studied the physics of drapery, so he was looking at how material would fold and how we could look at different colours and what those colours would look like in different lights. And so he would be able to predict what it should be doing under those light conditions and the way the material is folded and so on. And as I say, his understanding of anatomy was seconds enough for the time he spent on that and the dissections that he did. But really, what's interesting here is just how much he tried to actually put in terms of his understanding into a painting. And Martin Kemp would say that he actually tries to go beyond what a two-dimensional form in terms of the picture is able to hold, and that nowadays people might be more selective in what we might be trying to show. But I think part of it is that how many people would be as brilliant as Leonardo to have such an understanding across so many disciplines that they could try and show in the first place. So what I'd like to do now is to show you a few patterns that I found on my travels, and then looking at some of the ones that involve actually breaking up shapes into other shapes, because those, I think, give us the mathematical fodder, if you like, for use in the classroom. These Roman tiles are a really rich source of mathematical information. And I think it's interesting here, looking at the right-hand one from Pompeii, just how much overlap the actual pattern has with one on the left. And inside the squares, those repeating patterns, to me, they're reminiscent of what we get in the Alhambra. They're really quite similar there. And so, looking at these two examples, I've chosen two very simple patterns from the Alhambra. There were so many far more complicated ones. And so this was built during Islamic rule between the 13th and 15th century. It's a fortress in Granada in Spain. And you've got Islamic art on the surfaces because, of course, they wouldn't be showing the human form. What I like here is these symmetric repeating patterns. Like how if I look at just the blue, how the blue maps on just within the blue, and the white within just the white, but how also I might look at the transformation of getting, say, from the white to the blue, or the blue to the white. And again here, we've got the pattern there below. patterns are of particular interest to me, all made with hundred triangles here, because they're actually beginning to show a breaking up of an area into other shapes. And it's this breaking up, as I say, which I think provides a fantastic opportunity for working the classroom. If I'm looking at this quilting pattern that I saw in Estonia, if I look at the white square, and I can see the tilted square, I like within the white square, if I imagine that tilted square sitting on top of the white square, I can imagine folding the corners over into the centre. That will show me in a practical sense that the white square is double the area of the square that sits inside. Of course, I could be a little bit more formal than that, and I could use Pythagoras on the side legs of the little square to find its diagonal to confirm that root to 2 ratio there in side lengths and 1 to 2 ratio in the areas. If I look at the square, a much darker square, this little quilting pattern, you've got a big dark square outside, and I can see there looking at the dark square that the side length of the dark square is double the side length of the white square. And I can then look at the relationships there throughout that pattern in terms of lengths and areas. I like this one from Pompeii because sometimes when I look at this pattern, my eyes look at the top two-thirds of the pattern here. And when I'm looking at the top two-thirds of it, I can see that I've got two big squares side by side, and within that, I've got two tilted squares. And I feel drawn back to the YBC 7289 tablet. When I look at that, I feel it's that root 2 ratio all over again. And if I look back down at the bottom two-thirds of it, it's like a wheel the way I'm looking at it. I can see I've got black going round and four little triangles, and it's as if then the white ones are going back the other way, and that's just how it looks to me. But it's interesting that each of those big squares is still made up of eight of the same triangle. So this is what changed things for me, this image, when I first saw San Clemente Rome. To me, it was just mathematics buzzing up on the floor. I couldn't understand why other people were looking at the walls and looking at anything else around there. Once I saw that, I was gone for half an hour. My poor family is, I've got the camera, and there's a photograph in the ground. I just think that's beautiful. It's timeless, and it's beautiful. And I found out later that this was made from Roman ruins by the Cosmati artists in about the 12th century. And how the darker colours are much rarer. So when they've got a darker strip, they were kind of chopping it up, a bit like we might chop up food, and how they've had to break the pattern down to use less of those darker, rarer colours. And it is this breaking up of the Cosmati work, which I just find so fascinating and so lovely. And as I say, when I look back to the pattern of the Alhambra, I love them. But for me, this is the work for me for the classroom because it's this breaking up which enables us to work on equivalents. So I'd like to have a quick look at what I've done, some of what I've used in the classroom. So you've got some of these on your tables which we'll have a look at in a little bit. And these patterns are inspired by the Cosmati work as I've just shown you. I have thrown a couple of other shapes in there just to increase the number of combinations that we can do with equivalents. So the idea here is that we can actually look at a shape made up of other shapes and we can have some self-checking if we cover an area because we know that the areas must be equivalent. This enables us to look at connectivity, but it also enables students to be creative in that they can actually make patterns of their own and they can follow each other's lines of inquiry. They've got a shared dialogue because they've got the shared shapes there to look at. This is one of the tasks in the ATM assessment of the new national curriculum. So, what's the shape of another shape? It's about the vertices of the new shape coinciding with the vertices of the old shape. Don't say that they were inscribed within the shape, it's like the inverse of the shape of it. Okay, so what I would like you to do, on your tables, you've got bags, there's also a kind of a thicker plastic. The thicker plastic one, I could possibly have those bags to take back to school. The little plastic ones in the polythene bags, you can do whatever you like with those. If you really want to keep the plastic one for school, I'll go back and I'll make my excuses about the plastic one for school. But otherwise, in garbage, you can keep those at the very end of the whole session back in there. That's wonderful. So the idea is to just have a play, be creative, and just look at the relationships between legs and areas of your practice. You may also want to have a look at the fraction of shoulders. And I've also got the the expressions again that we were looking at with the cosmology type of tiles. If I look at the window on the right, I can might say I've got side length of x there, and I've got 3x by 3x is 9x squared, and of course how I might rearrange and make 9x squared look different, x by 9x and so on. Some more patterns from everyday life, which of course we can use in a similar sort of way to look at mathematical expressions. One of them is just a simple marquee, which again I thought was quite useful. I love these ones in Prague, and I call these sort of envelope patterns. And if I'm looking at that envelope, and I'm trying to say, well, what is it that makes it that sort of pattern? So I've got to have the kind of the horizontal line, and then the lines going off to the corners. So if I'm going to create that, how much of that can I generalise? So I might say I've got a specific length, a known length here, or I might give it a letter, and what's going on in the middle, what might be going on with the angles, and so on. Again, I like looking at the some of these other patterns they've got over the windows, and even all of these lines and triangles that formed within that shape. So, in my experience, some students find it quite difficult to really know what's going on when they're manipulating quadratic expressions in terms of factorising, in terms of collecting like terms, and having some sort of images of what's going on. On your tables, you've got one little pack between you of the templates that I've got here, should you want to play with. So, the idea is that there are three different types of templates. There's an x by x, the green square, there's a 1 by x, the blue, and there's a 1 by 1, the yellow. And the idea of this is that a student can actually see that the factorised and the unfactorised forms must have the same area by simple sort of conservation in that they're holding so close pieces. So if they begin by building a rectangle, they can consider the side lengths of the square of rectangle. So in this example here, I've got x plus 1 times x plus 1. I can see that by looking at the same side lengths there. If I want to consider the overall area, I can pick up each of the individual pieces to see that I've got the green x squared, I've got two of the circle 1 by x's, I've got 1, so I've got x squared by 2x and 1. I can present this to somebody else in an unfactorised form or apply the pieces, and they would then need to go back to build the rectangle. And that's something students, of course, can swap with one another. Here are some other examples of representations where we may move away from those exact templates into a more freehand style. And looking at some of the structures that we've just been discussing, x by x, x by 2x, looking on the right-hand side, x times by x plus 2 here, and I certainly found that students often confuse 2x with x and 2, and they tend not to think as much as they ought to about that bottom length, if that was, say, 2 lots of 5, and the other one was 5 and 2, and so on. And they can work with things like this in a particular, with a particular value for x, or in the general, as it's shown here. If they are looking at the overall rectangle on the right-hand side, you can see we've got x times x at 2. If I look at the two separate rectangles, I've got x squared and 2x, again reinforcing the equivalence between the factorised and the unfactorised form. The one at the bottom is one that we've been discussing a fair bit today, and two different ways of showing 2x on the square. And looking at diagrammatic representations, of course we can go further than that. I can collect up 3x and 4 and 2x. Looking at the common dimension, x there enables me to stack up those rectangles with the common dimension. And I can see then the 1 by 4 on the right-hand side. Where I think the cognitive conflict comes in is that if I move that green 4 by 1, I move it from here across to the left-hand side. It's difficult for somebody to say that they think the areas are different, and yet if I ask the students to work out 4 plus 5x, they may end up working out 9x rather than 4 plus 5x by misapplying the order of operations. And I feel that this idea of moving the 4 there and asking asking for an expression, it's more likely to get students to actually think about the fact that those two must be the same and to actually concentrate on the correct order operations that is going on there. And this is a basic area model for solving an equation. Again, you can see here, very self-explanatory, that 5x out of 3 is 38. And if you were to take off that little rectangle up at the top and go back to the main rectangle, you can reason that the main rectangle has got a smaller area than you started with, and then going down to find the side length of that main rectangle is the solution of the equation. Similar principle of the area shaded out. To go back to the main rectangle, adding in that extra 3, filling that 3 in, gives you a bigger area than the area you started with, and again, finding out the side length of the rectangle from that. Looking at this, in terms of the an equation with an unknown on both sides, this is sometimes called a quadratic cut between the and algebra, because the student cannot avoid but operate the unknown here. They cannot simply do this unless it's a really trivial example with arithmetic substitution. They're going to have to engage with the unknown, certainly if you make the examples complicated enough. And so the idea here is to subtract the largest possible rectangle from both. And so if I get rid of a 3x rectangle from both, that's then got me back into the kind of equation that students find much more trivial, into the 2x over 2 is 4, and so on. If you want to deal with something like 31 minus 3x, of course you're shading out that 3x to begin with, and you've then got to fill that hole back in, adding that into the right-hand side, and adding it into the left-hand side. And again, getting you that first tricky step back to an equation that students are much more comfortable with. Of course, the idea is that students can generate their own examples and swap one another, which is where the creativity comes in, and students can then have some ownership of the level of difficulty that they're working with. The next thing I'd like to have a play with is actually looking at some basic three arithmetic in a name or any other message that you would like to encode. So the idea here is that three beads, and you've got parts of beads on your table, three beads will make up a letter of the alphabet in base 3, according to the position of the letter. And then if you want to change those codes, go ahead. I know there are some people around this room that might think that's way too basic and they want to do something completely different with it. Feel free. So just showing it like this with A is 1, B is 2, C is 3, and so on. I'm looking at it in base 3 arithmetic. I've shown you the first ones there. The first bracket there is my name, it's Jackie. So the J is position 10, so I've chosen here. The red for me is 1, so I've got one lot of the 9, I've got none of the 3s, and I've got one lot of the 1. So looking at the place value, I've got 3 to the 0, 3 to the 1, 3 squared. So 1, 3, 9, 1 of the 9, 1 of the 1 makes 10 for the J, then the A, and then the C is the third one there, and then K, so J, K, and so on. So here, if I'm looking at one of the 9 and one of the 1 is 10, if I want 11, I need 2 of the 1, and so on. So I thought, my red is 1, my brown is 0, and my black is 2. So the idea is that if you choose for you what colour you want for each bead, just make sure you stick to the same colour. And that's my middle name there. So anybody work out what my middle name is? Except for Anna, because she knows me. My middle name. There's anything in fact my middle name. So we've got a good 15 minutes for you to have a go. You've got some string. It works quite well. Once you've chosen the colour for each bead. So choosing a bead colour for 0, for 1 and for 2. You can write out the whole alphabet if you want to and have a look up. You can even write colours to go for each. You should have about half a metre of the kind of thread of each. It works well if after every letter you do a knot. The black beads might sail over the knot, you want to duck, you may want to duck the knot. There's paper clips in case the holes in them aren't quite as big as they should be, but there's paper clips there, and have a play. Thank you.